The dogs continue to move south, stopping occasionally to listen, their very big, effective ears constantly swiveling around and trying to pick up sounds of potential prey. They move with the jog trot that is so distinctive to them. This gait is deceptive. It covers an incredible amount of ground very quickly. As with most of the predators in the area, they use the road network extensively. This is the path of least resistance for them, and they use it accordingly. At one stage, several of the dogs began scent marking on a particular bush. Normally, it's only the alpha male and female who will scent mark, and they'll tend to mark over each other. But this pack is a combination of two packs that joined recently, and there seems to be an ongoing shuffling and juggling and positioning to try and determine rank within this new pack. Three of these wild dogs have collars on, and while a bit unsightly, they form part of a extensive and very important research project in northern Botswana. Wild dogs are highly endangered predators, and it's important to understand their behavior and habitat requirements in order to conserve them. These play sessions, while very important in maintaining and strengthening these pack bonds, always fun to watch. At one stage, one of the females came back down the road. She approached the rest of the pack in a very typical submissive posture, head low, ears back. Wild dog social structures based on a very strange active submissiveness. This female walked past several members of the pack and eventually approached the female that we think is emerging as the alpha female. She proceeded to start licking her lips, and this is in an attempt to get the other female to regurgitate meat. Young pups and yearlings will do this to adults in an attempt to get them to regurgitate meat that they bring back to den sites for them, and this is clearly what this female was doing. It was a very interesting piece of behavior and very crucial to understanding wild dog pack structure.
Late afternoon, evening, and we are exploring a beautiful cave system on the edge of the forest. Our first delicate encounter is with one of the many species of violin spider which are found in cave systems around the world. This is a very poisonous spider and potentially lethal. Its web. Although it looks absolutely random, it is not. It is a deliberate three-dimensional structure evolved and designed to maximize this creature's survival in this wonderful and diverse world. From arachnid to amphibian, this little creature is a river toad, one of a species of Phrynoidus, and looks to me like Bufo asper. All amphibians are on the endangered species list, as worldwide they suffer the impositions of careless human living practices. I am drawn into the eye, intricate, magnificent, evolved and refined to perfect function. It is nocturnal, this little amphibian. Coming out at night onto the river bank, and especially on nights like this when the moon is full. And what a moon it is.
As I understand, this is a tabular iceberg, surrounded by pack ice. I spoke to people on our expedition, and I also did a little bit of research, and here's a list of the kinds of ices that we're looking at. Frazzel ice, ice cakes, old ice, pack ice, anchor ice, bergibits, brash ice, fast ice, floes, growlers, ice shelves. Throughout this open stretch of water, there were many birds to be seen. They were particularly difficult to film on the heaving decks, but we did pick up this grey-headed albatross. The physical sensation of being up close to these ginormous shapes, sometimes as big as an apartment box, towering up over our ship. Extremely humbling experience. Drama at sea. I can't find other words actually to describe this. The colors vary according to the ages, apparently. Also as a result of reflections from the sky. And every now and again, we were really fortunate to actually see some passengers. These are Adélie penguins, and I think they were as surprised to see us as what we were to see them. Almost like the captains of their ships, they had these ice floes in which they were traveling. How many kilometers they travel, I don't know. To give an indication of size is very difficult, a sense of proportion. But we can easily see here that some of these floes are at least as big as soccer fields. And another group of Adélie penguins. This time they clearly thought that they were not going to stick around for us.